Good evening and a warm welcome to all of you who have assembled today for the iCyclopedia, the AOS organized program on basics of glaucoma surgery. I am Dr. Murali Ariga from Chennai, and you're going to listen to a distinguished senior consultant in glaucoma, Dr. L. Vijaya from Shankaranethralayam. She is going to speak on basic surgical techniques in glaucoma. I think Dr. Vijaya needs no specific introduction, but I think for those of you who don't know, she has been the director of glaucoma at Shankaranethralaya earlier, and now she has been past president of the Glaucoma Society of India and also board member of the World Glaucoma Association. Without much ado, I'm going to request Dr. Vijaya to speak on basic surgical techniques in glaucoma. Following the talk, we're going to have time for discussion. Please don't forget to mail in your questions, and we will answer the queries as and when they come in. Dr. Vijaya.
Thanks, Murali. At the outset, I would like to thank AOS, especially Dr. Namrata Sharma, for this kind invitation to give this webinar today. And I also like to acknowledge my thanks to Cipla for making all the arrangements. The topic I chose is basic surgical techniques in glaucoma. So unlike cataract surgery, glaucoma surgery is evolving for almost more than 100 years because there are a lot of challenges. Even today, we don't have an ideal procedure that can be suitable for all glaucomas. So in other words, the indication for the surgery, choosing the surgery for a particular patient depends upon the clinical conditions. We don't have tailor-made solutions for glaucoma surgery. If you look at what surgeries we do for open-angle glaucoma, and we do mainly the penetrating surgery, that is the trabeculectomy, there are group of people who believe in non-penetrating surgeries in the world, and mainly they are the people in Europe. We also do a lot of glaucoma drainage devices, and the use of the glaucoma drainage devices have changed in the last few years. From using them in refractory glaucomas, we have even moved to close to the using them in some of the cases where they can be used as a primary procedure. Coming to the angle closure glaucoma, and we usually do surgery to modify the angle. If there is pupillary block, we try to do the iridectomy, that is done mainly with the laser to relieve the pupillary block. And there are also suggestions and the studies that have shown that by removing the lens, one can open up the angle so that it corrects the angle closure. So most of the time, lens extraction is recommended if there is significant cataract associated with it. And we also do a procedure called goniosynovialysis for angle closures, where the angle is closed because of the peripheral antisynicae. Under direct visualization, these synicae will be released in that procedure. Other than that, for angle closure, we do the trabeculectomy. We also do the glaucoma drainage devices. Non-penetrating surgeries doesn't work well for the angle closure glaucomas. Coming to the childhood glaucoma, the most common cause for the childhood glaucoma is angle dysgenesis, which we call it as a congenital glaucoma. And most of the time, the surgery preferred in such situations will be either goniotomy or trabeculotomy, where the dysgenesis will be addressed with this procedure. And in childhood glaucomas, there is a role for the filtration surgery, trabeculectomy with or without mitomycin C, especially the secondary glaucomas or refractory developmental glaucomas. And we also resort to drainage devices in children when the procedures which I mentioned doesn't work well in the follow-up. So why surgery for glaucoma? And if you look at the outcome out of the glaucoma, it's a very powerful procedure in the sense it's most powerful to lower the intraocular pressure. And most of the time, the resources for surgery are widely available with any anti-segment surgeon. And reasonably safe procedure if there is a good training for the surgery to be done. But one should remember there is a need for the training. That means people have to spend time to learn the procedures. And the same way in the post-operative follow-up, the glaucoma procedures, unlike cataract, needs very intense follow-up. So it is a labor-intensive procedure, both for the doctor as well as for the patient. So when do we do the surgery? So majority of the times, the surgery is indicated when the medical treatment or laser is not effective in maintaining the intraocular pressure. And we also consider surgery when the intraocular pressure is very high, when we think that either the medication or laser is not going to take care of controlling the intraocular pressure, one can go for the directly to the surgery. Sometimes patient may prefer, because of the difficulties involved in using the medication, if patient decides to go for the surgery, one may resort to the surgery. Non-surgical therapy are inappropriate. Suppose patient is not compliant and it is causing too much of side effects. We all know all glaucoma medications causes significant side effects because of the systemic absorption that can happen with the eye drops. And the third is socioeconomic problems. Using the medication for long term can be very taxing for the patient in terms of the finances. So the people who can't afford to use the medication in long term, one can go for the glaucoma surgery. So how do we decide surgery for glaucoma? Select an appropriate technique for the appropriate patient. As I mentioned, there are no tailor-made solutions for glaucoma surgeries. Discuss in detail with the patient what we are planning to do. Plan appropriate techniques to enhance the surgery. The long-term goal will be to maintain the intraocular pressure. So we have to plan appropriately what methods will yield the ideal outcomes. So what do we do when we do the trabeculectomy? To reduce the fibrosis, we use the antifibrotic agents. And the second thing what we do is, the term we use is called the wound modulation. That means in the post-operative period, whenever there is excess healing happening, we use the wound modulation techniques, either with the laser suture lysis or releasable sutures or with the massage, to increase the success rate for the trabeculectomy. So with this background, let's look at the commonly done procedures, starting with the trabeculectomy. So what is the, I said that trabeculectomy is still evolving because it has not yielded consistent results with everyone whom we advocate the procedure. The major cause for this is failure for the trabeculectomy is excessive healing at the conjunctival tenens facial episcleral interface. That is the healing between the conjunctiva tenens and episcleral interface. And this scarring response varies from person to person. So you cannot generalize everybody will react to the trabeculectomy in the same way. That is the reason the postoperatively these people have to be followed up very closely to reduce the healing process. How can we avoid scarring? So one way of doing it will be to identify the risk factors in the preoperative evaluation. What are the risk factors? Somebody has a neovascular glaucoma or had neovascular glaucoma in the past, or had a failed filter, or aphakia, or uveitis. These are all the people whom we categorize them as a high-risk patients for possible failure with the trabeculectomy. If you are planning to do trabeculectomy in these size, we may have to plan ahead of time, use of the antimetabolites. Second thing that can cause scarring will be conjunctival inflammation. It should be evaluated preoperatively, especially with the use of the multiple glaucoma medication in long term, there will be always some amount of ocular surface problem with the inflammation that can induce more scarring when we do the trabeculectomy. If there are allergies, these allergies should be taken care before we do the trabeculectomy. How else we can avoid the scarring? We can, perioperatively, we can avoid the scarring by minimizing the possible inflammatory stimulators. What are they? If you take care of the hemostasis, if there is no excess bleeding, that reduces the inflammation and scarring can be reduced. And use minimal diathermy and a good wound closure that helps in a good approximation of the wound and less amount of inflammation. Postoperatively also we can modulate the wound by advocating certain simple techniques by using the topical steroids to reduce the inflammation. But still if it is inflammation is significant, we do use subconjunctival 5-fluoroaerosol injection in addition to MMC what has been used during the surgery. How do we use 5F injections? The dose is 5 micrograms per injection. So we give maximum of 5 injections. So you take a 30 gauge needle, take the 5FU in that dosage, and after anesthetizing, inject subconjunctively away from the bleb. And as I indicated that we routinely use the antifibrotic agents because nowadays the most of the patients would have used the medication long term, so the chances of scarring is high. So mitomycin is the most commonly used medication. Should be used with caution. The trick is use the lowest concentration possible for the shortest period of time. In our hands, the dose that is ideal, we feel, is 0.4 milligram per ml for 1 minute of time. The key for it will be to use the mitomycin sponges for larger area. So when you apply the mitomycin for the larger area, you will get the so-called diffuse widespread blebs, not the localized blebs. What else we can do to reduce the trabeculectomy failure chances? Remember, any intraoperative complication can lead into the failure. So what does it mean? So when we close the trabeculectomy wound, at the end of the surgery, the eye should not be too soft. At the same time, eye should not be too hard. And anterior chamber should be well formed, and that there should not be any conjunctival wound leaks or dehiscence in the conjunctiva. These are the three things one should follow every time when we do the trabeculectomy to minimize the chances of the complications. Just to emphasize that the basic principle, preoperatively control the intraocular pressure. If the pressure is very high, consider giving IV mannitol to bring down the pressure, so that sudden decompression of the globe will not lead into problems. As I said, that during the closure, avoid the hypotony. Wound should be closed well and achieve large drainage area by applying the mitomycin C for larger area. Same way, using a releasable suture and releasing them in the postoperative period will give you a large surface area for the bleb to be formed. How do we do trabeculectomy? Usually it is done under local anesthesia most of the time, but people can use even parabulbar, even topical or subtenance. So whichever is the surgeon is comfortable, that is what is recommended. Traction suture is a must, either the corneal traction suture or superior rectus suture. Conjunctival flap can be fornix based or the limbal based. I already spoke about the MMC application. Scleral flap, routinely we do the triangular flap, but even people can use a rectangular trapezoid. It is individual choice. Internal ostium should be in the center. There should be at least 1 to 1.5 millimeter coverage of the scleral flap on either side to minimize the leak possibility. Iridectomy should be larger than the trabeculectomy stoma. Flap should be closed with the multiple releasable sutures, and the conjunctival closure should be perfect to avoid any leaks. Fornix-based flaps are easy to do it, but it gives better exposure, but most of the time there will be edge leaks in the immediate postoperative period, however careful you are with closing the conjunctiva. Limbal-based flaps are technically difficult, but gives better wound closure. I'll be just covering the disadvantage of the limbal-based flaps when we use the mitomycin as the lecture goes on. And conjunctiva should be dissected carefully. Use non-traumatizing forceps instruments during the procedure. And keep conjunctiva moist. And whenever we use the antimetabolites, the edge of the conjunctiva should not be covering the touching the sponges that we are using for the antimetabolites. And as I already mentioned, the scleral flap size and shape can vary, but what is important is the dissection should be uniform and it should be gentle manipulation. We also spoke about the sclerostomy should be in the center, and usually we prefer to take the apex as a releasable suture, two base sutures close to the base so that the flow will be more posterior, not to the sides. I did mention about the iridectomy. And postoperatively, what do we do? We measure the IOP, we evaluate the blood, we use the topical steroids, and cycloplegics are usually indicated in angle closures, and we have to take care of the problem by individualizing the patient. How do I assess the blood? Look for the presence of the microcysts. That indicates your blood is functioning well. Look for any leakage, because immediate postoperative leakage, if it is significant, can become a risk factor for the failure of the trabeculectomy with the time. And blood height and the vascularity. It should not be too vascular. If it's too vascular, it indicates ongoing inflammation that may require 5FE injection. And also give a little massage and see how is the flow, just to make sure there is a flow is good and the blood is forming well. And laser suture lysis should be considered whenever there is a significant reduction in the flow of the fluid, usually done effective within 2 weeks. But if when you use the antimetabolites where the healing has been delayed, the laser suture lysis is effective even up to 6 to 8 weeks of time. And there are various lenses available. Any lens is all right. How do we do it? Focus the suture well. Use the minimum power using the argon laser suture lysis to cut the suture. Remember to cut one suture at a time. If you cut more than one suture, the chances of the hypotony and hypotony-related complications like shallow antechamber and choroidals is very, very significant. And it is known to have some complications if one is not careful, like conjunctival burn, subconjunctival hemorrhage, and hyphema, etc. So as I mentioned, that you have to be careful, especially with the angle closures, where there is a risk of aqueous misdirection with the sudden shallowing of the anterior chamber that can happen with the laser suture lysis. One has to be extremely careful in advocating these techniques in angle closures. And also in eyes where they're susceptible for hypotony, like younger age and male are known to be risk factors for hypotony and hypotony maculopathy. And at the present scenario, if you look at the trabeculectomy, the number of the trabeculectomies have come down worldwide, including India. That's mainly because of the availability of the glaucoma medications. But unfortunately, the flip side of it will be because of the long-term usage of the glaucoma medications, whenever we do the surgery, they are at a higher risk for the failure with the trabeculectomy, and we may have to take care of those drug-related problems before we subject them for the trabeculectomy. And what is the goal of the surgery? Long-term maintenance of the functioning filtration. It remains to be a challenge even today. I have a small video that shows that how we do the trabeculectomy. This was with the superior rectus traction suture using the fornix based flap. A just sufficient conjunctiva was opened after hemostasis. You can see that a bigger sponges were applied for larger area, and a good clean dissection of the scleral flap. Here it is a triangular shaped scleral flap. So you visualize when you are dissecting it, and once the surgical limbus is identified, make the stoma. And this is the releasable suture being taken for the apical suture. So this is how we take the releasable sutures and make sure it is tight enough. And two base sutures at the base that kind of gives flow more posteriorly. Close the conjunctiva well with a either absorbable or non-absorbable suture. So when we do the limbal-based trabeculectomy, usually the blebs are little localized. That is mainly because the way the conjunctiva was incised, it produces scarring and it produces localized blebs. And these blebs are at a higher risk to develop the leaks because it is very localized. In contrast to this, what happened? I don't know, the picture is missing. Anyway, these fornix-based flaps are usually diffuse and they will not cause too many issues like leaking blebs over a period of time. So the next thing, quickly I will cover about the glaucoma drainage devices. And where do we do the glaucoma drainage devices? Even though there is a shift in recent time, but still at present point of time, in our scenario, these drainage devices are indicated whenever the filtering surgery fails or when the filtering surgery is not feasible because of technical difficulty or high risk of failure or high risk of bleb-related complications. What are the technical difficulties? If the conjunctiva is scarred like here or retracted, we can't do the trabeculectomy. Or in a post-penetrating keratoplastic glaucoma where the conjunctiva is not amenable for trabeculectomy or the antisegment is not amenable for trabeculectomy, we do the GDD. Similarly, post-vitreoretinal surgery. And also in eyes with scleral thinning, the trabeculectomy will be technically difficult. The thinning may be because of the scleritis, trauma, or the previous surgery. And ocular surface diseases, we know that the conjunctiva is altered and it is pathological, and it is technically difficult for a trabeculectomy to be done, so we do consider GDD. Where do we think the high risk of failure for the trabeculectomy? Refractive primary congenital or developmental glaucomas, eye syndrome, uveitic glaucomas, neovascular glaucomas where the trabeculectomy is likely to fail, and post-surgical glaucomas. And third is high risk of bleb-related complications. Where do we expect them? So these are individuals who work in dusty and dirty environment with the trabeculectomy can pose as a threat for the possible infection leading into the blebitis. Or people with a periocular skin disease, they can have the severe dryness and related issues leading into the bleb leaks and the bleb infections. People who want to use the contact lenses, trabeculectomy is not a suitable condition. And immunocompromised individuals where you fear there can be a possibility of bleb-related infection. So when we do the GDD, what do we consider? Anatomy of the eye and the orbit has to be taken into account. Posterior edge of the implant should be 2 millimeters from the optic nerve. If you use the most three commonly available devices, and multinode can be posterior, Ahmed valve, which is very commonly done at our institute, it is least amenable to the posterior placement. Bar weld or Adi, which is similar to bar weld, gives a lower profile bleb and it is suitable in the smaller eyes. Generally, the GDD can be divided into two groups. One is the valve, that is under that AGV comes, that is Ahmed valve comes. The second is the NAN valve, where the bar weld or the RD comes. So RD came into the market few years back. It is similar to the bar weld and it is a low cost indigenous device that is becoming quite popular in our country. It is a non-valved implant. All these have similar principles. What is that? You create a sclerostomy for the tube to enter the eye, for the fluid to drain. And this aqueous will be drained towards the equatorial area where the plate will be fixed. And when we fix the plate, make sure that you prevent the tube will not be obstructed. And this end plate creates a larger surface area around which a cavity forms and the fluid gets diffused into the conjunctival layers. That's how the pressure will be kept under control. What are the problems with the implants? You can have hypotony either in the early postoperative period or later postoperative period. And you can also have what we call it as a hypertensive phase. And that can lead into the long-term failure also. And not all the DDDs will work forever. And we do have significant 25% of them tend to fail over a period of time. What are the causes for the early hypotony? Leak around the tube. If the tube that we are introducing into the eye through a needle track, if it is a needle track is larger than the tube, you will have leak, so we should use appropriate size, 23 gauge or the 24 gauge needle is suitable. Or it may be because of the excessive filtration. Hypertensive phase is the, where does it occur? Usually, hypertensive phase is seen in 1 to 4 weeks, but followed by hypertensive phase, which begins 3 to 4 weeks after the operation and can last for 4 to 6 months. What does it happen? The blood becomes visibly inflamed and encapsulated and visibly associated with very high intraocular pressure. Over a period of time, once you control the inflammation and use the aqueous suppressants, the hypertensive phase kind of wears off. Where do we see the hypertensive phase? Most common with the valved Ahmed valve in comparison to the non-valved Bayer-Veldt or the Multinome. Why is it so? Because aqueous reaching the subconjunctival space in the early postoperative period with the valved device like AGV will take lot of inflammatory modulators along with it. They are supposed to produce lot of inflammation and lead into the hypertensive phase. So what is the solution for this? So start the aqueous suppressants in the immediate postoperative period, maybe on 10th day or 2 weeks later, so that the modulators will be reduced and this will prevent or at least reduce the hypertensive phase in 4 to 6 weeks time. And there are valve shunts are known to have immediate hypotony, like hypertensive phase is common, but by using the aqueous suppressants we can reduce that. In contrast to that, non-valve devices where the suture, the tube will be ligated to prevent the hypotony is less with the postoperative period, immediate postoperative period. Similarly, long-term encapsulation is supposed to be, the hypotony is more common in the immediate postoperative period, but it is known to be having less hypertensive phase over a period of time. It is a small video that shows how the AGV is done here. You can see it is all scarred conjunctiva. So conjunctiva is open and good undermining should be done. Priming of the tube should be done. And 8 millimeters from the limbus, the plate should be fixed using the 9-0 nylon non-absorbable suture. And after fixing the plate, the tube should be trimmed to the sufficient length. By creating a small track, the tube will be placed in the anterior chamber away from the cornea, parallel to the iris. And then the conjunctiva will be closed. Before that, you cover the tube either with the scleral graft or the corneal graft to prevent the erosion of the tube with the time. And the graft should be fixed. And conjunctiva is closed. How does it look postoperatively? You can see a well-placed plate with a good cavity around it and well-placed tube. So this is in general about some of the basic tips and the principles using the GDD. In brief, I will talk about the cataract and glaucoma because most of the time the both diseases existing in the same age group. Majority of the time we will be dealing with both. So you have to decide whether to do a combined surgery, you have to handle the glaucoma first, or you have to do only the cataract. How do we decide? There are several issues influence the approach. First and foremost is the severity of the glaucoma. If the glaucoma is severe, we tend to do both together. And what the postoperative IOP spike that can happen with the cataract surgery may be different in a healthy person versus somebody with a glaucoma. This spike can be disastrous for glaucoma patients. You have to take that into consideration. What is the extent of the cataract? What is the pupil size and zonular integrity? It is not very uncommon for a glaucoma patient to have issues with the zonules, especially the pseudo-exfoliation and also the angle closures. What options we have when we have both together? We can do the cataract surgery alone, or we can do the glaucoma surgery followed by the cataract surgery, or we can do both together. So when do we consider cataract surgery alone? If the cataract is significant and glaucoma is mild and the patient is not on many anti-glaucoma medications, we tend to do the clear corneal phacoemulsification. If somebody wants to do a small incision cataract surgery in such a situation, I would recommend to choose a temporal section rather than the 12 o'clock section, because you have to preserve the conjunctiva and the tissue in the underneath the eyelid for the future glaucoma surgery. And as I mentioned, the risk of AAON and progression of the glaucoma is always possible whenever there is a spike in the intraocular pressure. How can we minimize that? So the good clearing of the viscoelastic on the table. Intraoperative myotic is known to reduce the intraocular pressure, especially the pilocarpine, what we use intraoperatively for meiosis, or you can routinely use tablet acetazolamide. So cataract surgery after filtration, and whenever we that is do the trabeculectomy first followed by the cataract surgery. But whenever we do such a thing, there is always a compromise on the filtration. The filtration can fail because of the added inflammation that happens with the cataract surgery. And again, ideal approach will be clear corneal. One may have to resort to intensive topical steroids to minimize the inflammation and reduce the chances of the failure, or one can resort to subconjunctival 5-FU injection. This is one of the cases where you see functioning filtering bleb with a significant cataract. By having a clear corneal section away from the bleb site, you can see the bleb is maintained well and has a good pseudophakia. So when do we do the combined cataract and glaucoma surgery? As I mentioned that if it is uncontrolled glaucoma, a patient is on multiple drugs and severe glaucoma, and borderline to inadequate bleb function if somebody has, you don't hesitate to do a cataract with a retrabeculectomy in such a situation. Combined surgery is convenient because only with one surgery patient will kind of gets treated for the both. Visual rehabilitation is faster. Postoperative IOP spikes that happens only with the cataract surgery is unlikely to happen with the combined surgery. But remember, the filtration what you get with the combined surgery will not be equal to the just the trabeculectomy alone. So it will be suboptimal whenever we do the combined procedure. And these two are seen more often. Modern surgical procedures has improved our success. What are they? Phacoemulsification. Phacoemulsification has made a huge difference for the glaucoma patients. And similarly, the wound modulation techniques, what I talked about, has improved the surgical success rate. A small video, a Phoenix-based flap, mitomycin C is applied. And here it is a single-site trabeculectomy where you use the scleral tunnel to after appropriate diathermy. The tunnel should be more posterior than the usual scleral tunnel what we do for the SACS or for the scleral tunnel phacoemulsification. It should be 2 to 2.25 millimeters from the limbus. And after creating the scleral tunnel, the routine cataract surgery will be done. Most of the time, glaucoma patients tend to defer their cataract surgery because of the fear of losing the vision. So many times you will end up with very dense cataracts. It's very common to see glaucoma patients having very, very hard cataracts. After the cataract, the lens will be implanted in the back and created trabeculectomy stroma underneath the flap. Similar surgical techniques, it should be in the center. make a good iridectomy, and close the flap the whichever way is convenient, either with the releasables or absorbable sutures like Vicryl, and close the conjunctiva. Again, conjunctival closure should be meticulous to avoid any postoperative leaks and hypotony related issues. As I mentioned, again, most of the time we do it with the Pharnix based, but there is nothing wrong if one resorts to the Limbal based. Antifibrotic agents are commonly used. One site or two site doesn't show any edge for the one over the other. It is individual choice. As I mentioned, mitomycin C is used 0.4 milligrams for 1 minute. That is the ideal duration and concentration we found that works well with minimal complications in our hand. This is one of the postoperative picture showing a good diffuse bleb and well-placed IVL in the back. What are the other issues one can face? The small pupil. Small pupil may be because of the myotics or the posterior synechiae or the old age. How do we assess? We have to assess preoperatively for better planning. Dynamic way of assessing will be pupillary reaction. If the pupillary reaction is not good enough, you know this pupil is going to give trouble. And static way of assessment will be after dilatation, reassess the size of the pupil and make a note in the file. That is post-mydriasis evaluation of the pupillary size. Use good viscoelastics, and one may have to resort to the other mechanical devices like iris hooks or Baylor pupil dilator or Kuglin hooks using the pull and push technique. And zonular dehiscence, one should be prepared, as I mentioned before. And various factors influence how we manage cataract and glaucoma. Decision should be individualized. Surgeon comfortable level is utmost important, because if surgeon is not comfortable with one technique, I think there is no point advocating that technique. So points to remember when we manage both cataract and glaucoma. Combined cataract and glaucoma procedures are usually performed when there is a pressing need both to control IOP and to remove a visually significant cataract. If the surgeries can be performed sequentially, typically the cataract procedure is performed before the glaucoma surgery. Uncomplicated phacoemulsification surgery with a clear corneal incision may create problems with a previously functioning filtering bleb. This has to be kept in mind. Preventing an excessive wound healing response in the area of the bleb is an important consideration in combined procedures. These are all the some of my thoughts regarding the basic principle techniques that is commonly done by most of us in our practices. And thank you very much for your kind attention. If there are any questions, I think Dr. Murali is here to moderate the session. So please do share the questions with us. Thank you.
I think you all heard a wonderful lecture on every aspect of glaucoma surgery that you could think of, the basics of trabeculectomy, the basics of doing a glaucoma drainage device, also how to handle the coexistent problem of cataract with glaucoma. I think Madam has covered almost every aspect you can possibly think of, and if you still have any doubts, of course, we are here to answer the questions. There have been a few questions that have reached us here. I think I'll probably put up the questions one by one and request Madam to answer them. The first question we have received is surgery required for glaucoma even if the glaucoma management has been good with anti-glaucoma medication? So do we need to operate on a patient if the patient is doing well with glaucoma medication?
Thanks, Murali. I will request you also to answer some of these questions. I think the question came up before we started the session, and I did address this question specifically, saying that we go for the glaucoma surgery when the medical management is not enough, our patient is not compliant, our socioeconomically patient can't afford this continuing the medication. These are the if patient is comfortable if glaucoma is stable, there is no need to do the glaucoma surgery in such individual. Do you have anything to add?
No, I think I agree with that. And when patient is doing very well with medication, we cannot really ensure 100% success all the time with glaucoma surgery. I think we do need to proceed with caution. When patient is doing well with one form of treatment, why would you want to go in and operate? I entirely agree with that, ma'am. And the next question to madam is, what should be, I think you had suggested the use of subconjunctival 5-fluorouracil after glaucoma surgery has been performed. What should be the interval between two injections of the 5-FU? I think you did mention 5 injections. So what should be the time interval between injections?
5 is the maximum that works well for our in our hands. And there is no specific time period. But it should not be given all in the same day. It can be spread over a week to 10 days also. There is no need to complete all 5 injections. If patient healing response has come down with one injection, there is no need to go for the second. At the same time, each time when we give the injection, we have to look for the possible complications of the 5-FU. Like if there is a wound leak, we don't give the 5-FU. If there is any epithelial toxicity which 5-FU is known to produce, especially if the injection spills from the subconjunctant space into the conjunctival cul-de-sac, epithelium can develop toxicity, so we should not repeat. Same way, any hypertonic choroidals, we don't give the 5-FU.
I agree, ma'am. I think the use of 5-FU has to be judged on a case-to-case basis, and there is no fixed post-op regimen in all patients and so on. And also with regards to the type of injection, with regards to the injection of 5-FU subconjunctival injection, I think many of us would probably even consider as a bleb needling with 5-FU that has also been considered when the bleb is failing and scarring. So I think we need to look at the patient like madam had mentioned. The post-operative follow-up of a glaucoma surgery patient is extremely important. We need to monitor at least on a weekly, if not more frequent basis, to see how the bleb is doing well, the antechamber, the intraocular pressure, the vascularity of the bleb, and then don't hesitate to intervene and don't hesitate to do another procedure to ensure the success of the surgery. Don't simply send away the patient for a month or two and then realize that the bleb has failed. I think a post-operative follow-up, I think madam has already emphasized that the post-operative follow-up is extremely important in the management of glaucoma surgery. And there are a few more questions. Please elaborate on your experience with the use of Ologen.
I think you are the right person. I do use it, but my indications are limited. Maybe you can respond to that.
Yes, ma'am. The Ologen actually is a collagen implant, and it has been commercially available. The trade name is Ologen. I think it is glycosaminoglycan with atelocollagen mix of both. It's supposed to be a porous material available in various sizes. And the main reason for using Ologen in our glaucoma surgeries is that we try to reduce, like madam was mentioning, we try to reduce the post-operative fibrosis. So the use of Ologen is supposed to cause the fibroblast to go randomly through the sponge-like pores of the Ologen. So during the trabeculectomy surgery, you make this scleral flap, triangle or any other method of the flap is made. Apply a releasable suture also. The Ologen, I usually use a 6 millimeter diameter Ologen, 2 millimeter thickness. So we place the Ologen about just a millimeter or two behind the apex of the flap. And then you sort of loosely suture the flap, or you have a releasable suture and have the conjunctiva covering that. And this is in place of using the mitomycin. Wherever we don't want to use mitomycin for some reason, such as very high myopes, and in patients whom we feel that there's going to be a risk of hypertonia or mitomycin related complications, that is where the Ologen comes in. As a routine, we do not use Ologen in all patients because of various issues. One, of course, is the cost of the Ologen itself. The cost is about, I think in Indian rupees, about 6,000 to 8,000 rupees per implant. So it is not possible to do expensive implants for all glaucoma patients. And I think the published literature about the success of Ologen trabeculectomy versus mitomycin trabeculectomy has shown recently that mitomycin trabeculectomy definitely has an edge as far as intraocular pressure and success is concerned. But the possibility of complications are there with the mitomycin, which is why many of us use the Ologen. Some of the advantages of Ologen is that the postoperative shallow AC, the postoperative inflammation, postoperative the flap problems, all those issues are probably a little less with the use of Ologen. Anything else you'd like to add?
I think surgically, I think it is what we have to remember is whenever we use the Ologen, there should be constant flow of the aqueous. If your wound is too tight, the Ologen becomes very dry and then it doesn't serve the purpose and your surgery is likely to failure. That is so that because of that, your wound has to, the aqueous has to be continuously flowing and either have to have the loose suture or the releasables. I prefer to use the releasable sutures so that you can remove them in the first 1 week to 10 days, all the three sutures. Second thing, I feel that when we use the phonics-based flap, whenever the Ologel swells up, it tends to retract the conjunctiva. So the conjunctiva closure has to be very good, otherwise there is a small risk of exposure of the Ologen and the possible infection later on.
Yes, I think there has also been a very recent publication about the use of mitomycin with Ologen together, and that I think I would personally consider it very risky using mitomycin with the Ologen. And actually a recent publication from the RP Center has clearly shown that there is no difference in success rate as far as mitomycin versus combining Ologen with mitomycin. Some centers have shown disastrous complications with the use of mitomycin along with the Ologen. So I would definitely advise caution that you should not use both at the same time, either you use mitomycin or use Ologen, depending on the clinical situation, the patient's ability to afford, and your way of and your ability to handle the surgery. I think we'll move on. We have quite a lot of questions actually. One of the other questions is that about the use of 0.4 mg per ml for 1 minute versus the 0.2 mg for 2 minutes, and which is better and why?
We came down to 0.4 per 1 minute because almost 20 years back we have done a study where we looked at the concentration versus the timing. That's how we derived. And ultimately what works well in your hand is what is best for you. And the principle is try to use a shorter duration and lower concentration.
I think I also agree with madam that the use of mitomycin and the dosage has to, the timing has to be titrated on individual basis and your own experience with the usage of the drug itself. There is no single answer to this. I think you have to definitely develop your own method of applying and the duration. But as a start off guideline, I think we can suggest 0.4 for 1 or even a 0.2 for 2 as the question has come. The other question, one other question has been, what about trabeculectomy surgery in cases of a foveal split? I think the question implies advanced glaucomas where there is a foveal split on visual fields, and is surgery safe? I think that's what the question implies.
Okay, I think there is a notion that the wipeout can happen with the glaucoma surgery. My colleague Dr. Shanta has done prospectively a study at Shankanethralaya, and she published it also, where she kind of chose all the patients with the split fixation on visual fields, especially using the macular threshold. And she found there was no risk of wipeout in these patients if you take appropriate precautions. What are the appropriate precautions? Make sure that the IOP spike doesn't happen in the immediate postoperative period, and you don't hesitate to give on the first day, because first day spike is the most dangerous. You don't hesitate to give the acetazolamide for the patient for first day to avoid such a spike. I think if you are careful enough, this is not a major complication in my experience.
Yes, ma'am. The take-home message is that do not hesitate to operate on advanced glaucomas because it is definitely safe, and the risk of having a so-called wipeout with advanced glaucomas and split fixation is the complication. The risk is very low. I think you can go ahead and operate. I would probably equate the risk of a wipeout after glaucoma surgery to the risk of having endophthalmitis after cataract surgery. So we don't stop operating cataract because we know there's a risk of endophthalmitis. Similarly, we do have this possibility in mind, but I think we should not stop operating because of this so-called risk. And the next question to us is, trabeculectomy with a punch, how exactly should the punch be oriented while punching? Should it be parallel to the iris or slightly vertical? So,
what do you do? I always tell all my people to keep it vertical once you make the incision anteriorly. Correct. So then you get a clean cut.
I think a vertical makes sense.
Yeah, if it is parallel, you may end up with like a tunnel.
Correct. Correct. Maybe the size of the ostium is what I think you probably
bring. 0.75.
But most of us would use a 0.75 or a 1 mm punch. Maybe a couple of times you would punch. So you end up with a 1.5 or a little less than 2 mm ostium. The size of the ostium is not that critical, provided you make it at least 1.5 or more. If you make it less than 1, I think probably the chance of not filtering is always there. So, and as Madam mentioned, the ostium should be in the center of the flap which you have made, a 4 or 5 mm flap, and in the center of that, the flap should be, the ostium should be made. And a half thickness scleral flap is what Madam also mentioned. When do you go for MIGS is another question. So MIGS, I think you all know what MIGS means. It's so-called micro-invasive glaucoma surgery, which is very popular in Europe and in the so-called West.
Minimally invasive glaucoma surgery.
People even call it minimally effective glaucoma surgery. So I think we don't have MIGS in India, I think. Some of the MIGS are probably going to come in the near future. Something like the iStent and the Zen and some implants which already come in the market have been withdrawn, like the CyPass has been withdrawn, we believe. The MIGS is not yet here in India. It's probably going to come. What MIGS means is that you can do it ab internal, that is from the inside of the eye through the trabecular meshwork. You can also do ab external from the outside. All of these are so-called relatively micro-invasive surgeries are supposed to enhance outflow through the trabecular meshwork and by various methods. They are expensive and still being evaluated. Many of them have been evaluated along with cataract surgery in the West. So we don't really know how it would fit into our patients where we have a significant number of angle closure patients also. So I think we really have to wait and see. We don't really have a definite answer as to what to do with the MIGS, at least in our situation.
Yeah, I agree. I think it's basically, if you look at the outcomes of what our studies has done, it comes between your medication and the so-called glaucoma procedure comes this phase. So it is not replaceable for your glaucoma surgeries. It can take away the use of the medication, at least 1 or 2 drops from the patient. More than that, you can't expect anything beyond that. The cost is going to be a big factor. So we have to wait and see how
very expensive, very, very expensive. And some of these eye stents we hear, they even put in 2 eye stents in the same eye and each eye stent costs upwards of $1,000. So I think cost would be a very significant factor, at least in India. And one question here is about the glaucoma medication. Which glaucoma, anti-glaucoma medication can cause trabeculectomy failure? I think the question implies, suppose you've been using the medication for some time, and how would you say that this particular patient is going to have a TRAB failure and so on?
I did not say that particular drug will cause the failure. It is a long-term usage of the glaucoma medication can alter the ocular surface. So if you look at the ocular surface, the 2 drugs that are likely to produce a lot of changes, one is brimonidine, the other is carbonic anhydrase inhibitor group of dorazolamide and brinzolamide. These are the drugs are likely to produce reaction, papillary reaction in the and joint papillary conjunctivitis in the conjunctival cul-de-sacs, and these situations can cause more fibrosis and failure. You cannot say that directly the drug is the cause. Similarly, long-term usage of the glaucoma medication, because of the preservative, most of the glaucoma medication preservative is a benzalkonium chloride. Benzalkonium chloride is known to produce ocular surface disease with the time. So that itself can cause more fibrosis and failure of the glaucoma surgery.
I agree, ma'am. Some of us, I think, probably stop the glaucoma medication maybe for a short period, or even continue use a little bit of topical steroid to so-called reduce the inflammation and maybe get the goblet cells to sort of rejuvenate or something like that. And having used glaucoma medication for a long period of time in the preoperative period will definitely reduce the chance of a surgical success. We have to keep that in mind definitely. We'll probably have a few more questions, and What is superior for IOP control in the long term? Is it medication or is it surgery? Compared to surgery, is medication better?
I mean, long-term control of the intraocular pressure, surgery definitely has an edge over the medication if once you do the surgery. But it again depends upon the success of the surgery. One advantage with the surgery is the diurnal fluctuation that happens with the medication will get blunted with the surgery. So the intraocular pressure remains more or less the same throughout the day.
I think maybe we can probably talk about the so-called collaborative initial glaucoma treatment study also, which initially showed that suppose you have a glaucoma patient, which would you like to start off with? The study had shown that both medication as well as surgery showed equal lowering of intraocular pressure, probably equal slowing of the progression, with probably less of cataract formation with the glaucoma surgery itself. I mean, with the medication, when you're doing glaucoma surgery, trabeclectomy in particular, I think in about 5 years, you'll definitely end up with a cataract. So that is also has to be kept in mind. What is intractable glaucoma and its management? I think Madam did discuss that. That is, intractable glaucoma usually means Medicare glaucoma not responding to the usual treatment and surgeries. So I think Madam had discussed the role of glaucoma drainage devices for intractable glaucoma. And another question is about why do we need a superior rectus suture? I think Madam also mentioned that that we do need to have a traction suture, either as superior rectus or as a corneal traction suture. It would definitely help us to have a good exposure of the field for surgery. I think a superior rectus suture has been given up by many of the glaucoma surgeons now. Most of us would probably use a corneal traction suture. Is that right, ma'am?
So yeah, I think when I use the subtenons if you have a good speculum, if your exposure is good enough, there is no need for the traction suture. For the majority of the cases, like Murali has indicated, for a better exposure, a traction suture helps.
Does IV mannitol help on the day of surgery?
Yes, especially the angle closures. I think
Madam also mentioned that the IOP has to be lowered well before the surgery. Do not operate on an eye in which intraocular pressure is very high. If you have 40 pressures or 60 pressures, don't go ahead and do a trabeclectomy immediately. Probably wait for the intraocular pressure to get controlled and definitely consider, like in the angle closure, particularly give intravenous mannitol, get the pressure down, make it comfortable for you to operate rather than have very hard eye when you're operating. I think it definitely makes sense. If Ologen bleb is failing, do you use 5-FU?
I don't hesitate to do the needling.
Correct.
When I do the needling, because I don't use the mitomycin.
The principle of Ologen itself has been to sort of avoid the fibrosis by allowing this fibroblast to go through this pores. And using a 5-FU would actually defeat the purpose, and I think probably does not make sense to use 5-FU. Maybe handle the reusable suture, maybe you can even needle. I have needle blebs in which Ologen has been done. I think that works. That works well. I think probably 5-FU is not a good idea as far as Ologen blebs are concerned. There's a long case report which will probably how to place the reusable sutures. I think Madam did show the video of how to place
it's very quick
suture.
Because of the time. It's again, people use it different techniques. The basic technique is you go through the cornea, go through the flap, and go through the apex or the side wherever you want to take the releasable suture. And then good thing is at least 4 throws should be there when you put the slip knot. Otherwise, there is a possibility of the knot giving way in the postoperative period. So there are different techniques, and with the limited time, I think it's not possible to describe. I would suggest any basic textbook will be able to give you the information.
Yes, I think a releasable suture has so many techniques and methods. Whichever works best in your institution, your hands, I think you must apply that. There have been very simple methods of applying a releasable suture. I think many of us also have videos online. You can probably view the videos online, or maybe make a request. We can actually have some method of sending it across to you. Any role of tenonectomy in trabeclectomy and how much to do?
I don't.
I also do not do a tenonectomy. I think with the use of antimetabolite, it is actually dangerous to remove the tenons, and tenonectomy is not a good idea unless you really have some extraordinarily thick, very thick tenons. It's probably not a good idea to remove the tenons. Could you ensure zero refractive error after combined cataract and glaucoma surgery? What is the induced spherical or cylindrical power in your hands? I think it's a very interesting question. We actually, as glaucoma surgeons, do not think of the vision so much. We concentrate more on the intraocular pressure and maybe the glaucoma. I think this is food for thought, ma'am.
Yeah, it is food for thought, but I don't see too much of a difference between my routine cataracts and my combined phaco traps. I have not really have not seen
thought
that.
About it, but
the only having said that, I think when you make the punch, when you make this, if you are using the single site, if you are dissecting onto the cornea and making the trabeculectomy, you have to be within your surgical limbus. If you go anterior to the surgical limbus, there is a high possibility you will break that so-called
astigmatic funnel.
And then you end up with the astigmatism. As long as you follow this simple rule, I think your astigmatism will not be totally different from the cataracts.
I think you should analyze your own results of cataract glaucoma surgery, the way you place the, make the flap, the way you place the incision for the cataract, the way you switch your things, and you will probably know yourself what is your outcome. And probably I would suggest not to do a toric IOL in such situations, especially correcting toric IOL and astigmatism. Probably aim for spherical corrections. Don't go for toric IOLs, because I don't think you will get predictable outcomes and the accuracy of surgery will not be there. That's all I can say. Otherwise, I think, like Madam mentioned, I think you really have to...
I think in a similar note, I also... it is a controversial question whether to use the multifocal or not. I think in my glaucoma patients, I never advise the multifocal for them, because so many issues. The patient is already compromised with the visual function. Taking away the contrast some more may not be an ideal condition. That's my
yes, ma'am. I think multifocals, we all would definitely agree, would reduce the contrast and increase the glare for a patient. Doing visual fields may become a problem subsequently. So I think multifocal lenses, definitely know when you're doing combined surgery, at least advanced glaucoma, significant field defects. Maybe a very mild glaucoma, you're doing only a cataract surgery and patient understands things well, you could probably consider, it's not an absolute contraindication, maybe you could consider in certain glaucoma patients when combined surgery is not thought of. Topical glaucoma medication in pregnancy. I think this is the top has been, talk has been on glaucoma surgery, I think, but this is a relevant question maybe. Topical anti-glaucoma medication in during pregnancy.
I think there is some good literature available. I think they looked at the evidence ABC using the available medication for the pregnant women. We don't have the absolute information and indication. But I think the brimonidine was found to be safer in comparison to the rest of the glaucoma medication in the available literature. And but remember that no drug...
One important question that I think needs to be addressed in this list of questions is that do we recommend the use of atropine post-trabeculectomy in patients when there's a loss of AC in angle closure glaucomas and so on? I think this is a very important question. I think Madam will answer that.
Atropine is routinely used in all angle closure glaucomas when we do the glaucoma surgery, that mainly because that these eyes are at a risk to develop shallow antechamber, and that is in turn will cause aqueous misdirection. So atropine helps in relaxing the zonules and taking the lens iris diaphragm backwards. So first 1 or 2 weeks use of the atropine will make a lot of difference for these patients.
Definitely. And the use of a cycloplegic, I think, has to be emphasized. At the same time, the role of the iridectomy also, I think Madam has clearly shown, the iridectomy is also very important. Use of the iridectomy, do the iridectomy and also make sure you use a cycloplegic to keep the anterior chamber deep and prevent problems like malignant glaucoma. One last and very interesting question again, I think probably not relevant to today's practice, is the how effective is a Fugo blade for glaucoma surgery, like trans-AAA filtration as compared to TRAB?
I really don't have any experience.
I have seen a few live surgeries of the Fugo blade when Professor Daljit Singh used to operate earlier, and I have seen some of his post-operative results as well after maybe 6 months or a year. I do not know from publication and from his own experience that the Fugo blade probably has a relatively short-lived effect, and I really don't have answers to this question. I think we had a very interesting question answer session. We also had an excellent talk and lecture from, you heard the stalwart in glaucoma surgery talk about every aspect of trabeculectomy, combined surgery and glaucoma drainage surgery. We've answered quite a few questions from colleagues and students from across India. And I sincerely thank Madam Vijaya for being here and talking to us, the lecturing about the basics of glaucoma surgery. I also thank AOS and CIPLA for the opportunity. Madam.
Thanks, Murli, on a working day, coming and staying with us and moderating the session. And thank you very much. If you still have any questions, you can always send it to the CIPLA if we get it with your email ID. Whatever we have not answered, I try to answer them by mail, maybe before the weekend. Thank you very much for your participation. Thanks again, AOS and CIPLA, for this.
Thank you all, and thank you all for attending.